Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another session of the 48th Annual Conference of the Lusall American Education Foundation. This one is, of course, dedicated to the theme of routes and roots. And we are looking at our roots, of course, and we're looking at the various routes that have made our community what it is, and our diaspora, and our building of identities throughout the time in the Portuguese American world. Very heavy, of course, here in California on the Azorean American world, but also a presence from mainland Portugal and Madeira as well. We're very happy and thrilled, I should say, to have Dr. Monique Kelly Valence, PhD in Portuguese history from the University of Santa Barbara. We miss having our weekly segments on the Portuguese American Hour that Monique did for a couple of years. But we have her here in person with this presentation, as you can see. When we thought about this theme, in Portuguese, raízes e rotas, or roots and routes, we thought, you know, we need to kind of establish, you know, we have been talking, and we will continue until it ends on Saturday at 1 o'clock, about the different paths that the Portuguese Americans have taken in different parts of not just California, but the United States, a little bit of information also from Canada. We have a very interesting presentation tomorrow about Hawaii. But this kind of began, you know, in a way with the discoveries. That was the era that, you know, kind of plunged us in to the world. And as our good friend that many of you know in the diaspora, Onesimo Almeida, the professor now emeritus from Brown, used to say, you know, the discoveries to the Europeans and the Portuguese discoveries to the Europeans are kind of like space travel was to America. It's, you know, it was the new frontier. And it was a very, very important time for Portugal, for Europe, and for the world. And so, Monique, thank you so much for agreeing to take time from your busy schedule. We miss you having you as a historian on our weekly segments, but we're going to probably call on you once in a while, as we always do, because you are the specialist in, of course, the Portuguese history in from a California perspective, as that you did your PhD in Santa Barbara on Portuguese history. And unfortunately, there hasn't been too many after you, I don't think. It's one of those fields that Portuguese Americans don't get into as much as we would like to. We're even having some issues trying to get some young Portuguese Americans at Fresno State to do a master's. We have one right now that we're enticing into doing a master's on issues dealing with the Portuguese American community. Some of the things that you and I have spoken so many times that we don't know anything about, you know, I mean, how exactly did the first queen begin? You know, how did this, you know, there's a lot of investigative work that needs to be done. And sometimes we just don't have, unfortunately, the resources or the people that want to do it. And so thank you so much for taking time. As folks can see, it's about the Portuguese discoveries. And again, Dr. Monique Kelly Valence is the person that we call upon when we want to know a lot about the Portuguese history. And I really miss all of the details that we used to get on the Portuguese monarchy, that I should say that, you know, you have a PhD in history and you know everything there is to be known about the Portuguese history. You've studied all the different eras, but I always find it fascinating, your dedication to the monarchy. And as I tell my students, even just last week, my history, culture, and lit class on the Azores, we kind of tend to forget that Portugal is a very young republic. It was a monarchy it's going to be a few hundred years more before we are more of a republic than a monarchy, because we were there for quite a few centuries. So welcome. Thank you so much on behalf of Lusall America and certainly on behalf of PBPI from Fresno State.
Thank you. Thank you, Dinesh, for inviting me to be here. Thank you to the Lusall Education Foundation, PBPI, and thank you for all of you who are signing in or who might watch this later. Just a couple of comments, Dinesh. So it's not just our Portuguese Americans that aren't interested, but also our neighbors in Portugal, also not that interested in Portuguese history. So we always had a joke in my department that in Portuguese history, if something was done, that meant there was one book written about it. And if something was overdone, that means there were two books written about it. So it's not just us, unfortunately. But that just leaves more for the rest of us to discover. And I think my interest in the monarchy is because I must have been a queen in a past life. So that's what I want to believe. okay, so let me just start again. Okay, so when we think of, when at least when I think of the Portuguese discoveries, right, we always think of the ocean. And the ocean just has so much connection to us as Portuguese people, Azoreans, Madeirenses from Brazil. I feel like probably that's what connects the whole diaspora, is just this ocean. And where we are now, as far as a Portuguese-speaking culture and community, really originates from here. So a couple of friends of mine just recently went to Portugal for the first time, and they asked me to give them some tips about places that they could visit on their journey. And they mentioned that they were going to be going to the Algarve. And one of the places I recommended there was to go to the Cabo de São Vicente, picture where you see here, or the Cape of St. Vincent. This is the most southwesterly point of Europe. If you visit there today, as you see in the picture, you can see a lighthouse. There's 15th century fortress and church. There's some these cliffs reach up to 75 meters in height. And I wonder how many people realize that this very location is the center of one of the most important moments in Portuguese, European, and even world history. When I visit historical monuments or places, I always like to imagine the way people thought or felt when they were standing in that very place hundreds of years before. So when you stand there, you know, this is the place where the sailors set sail to explore the Atlantic. They were setting forth on an unknown expedition, facing an often cruel and unforgiving ocean, hoping that their work and sacrifice would bring great yields for themselves and their kings. The more uneducated people thought that the world ended here. And if you go there today, it's easy to see why. The sun sinks into the ocean over the horizon, and there's nothing else visible to the west. One note I always like to mention here is that, you know, that when, at least when I was in high school, I felt like we were always taught that, you know, people in the medieval period thought the world was flat. They thought they were going to fall off the ocean. That is not true for sailors, for scientists, the royalty, anybody who was educated. They all knew the world was round. In fact, even the ancient Greeks had calculated the size of the earth almost down to the square meter. So without calculators, without computers, without GPS, they knew how big the world was. And it's, you know, it's just amazing what we were able to accomplish just by knowing that fact and being able to do that without the help of computers and modern technology. So when we discuss Portugal's role in the discoveries, there are two questions we're going to look at today. I feel like, you know, the actual events of what happened, where we went, what we did, those kind of get talked about a lot. And, you know, hopefully most kids learn this in high school history. Although when I was teaching college, I found that there was some disappointment on my end on things that they had not learned. Of course, it means they were taught that to defend teachers, because a lot of times they get taught things that they don't remember. But there are a couple of things that we don't normally seem to focus on. And a lot of Portuguese, or I would say, I'm sorry, not Portuguese, but a lot of history classes don't focus on these two things. So first is, with so much strife going on in Europe during the medieval period, why did anyone feel the need to venture forth, risking their lives and fortunes to brave the wild oceans? And secondly, how did Portugal manage to outmaneuver all the other countries to be the first ones to make it to India? And if we have time, the third would be, what effects do those explorations have on the wider world? So of course, spices like pepper and cinnamon were highly sought after in Europe for a couple of reasons. One, it made the food taste better, especially since Europeans didn't have access to things like chili peppers. So it helped with the bland taste of the food. Anyone goes to England, we all know how bad the cuisine can be there. And it also helped cover up the taste of meat if it's a little past the stew date. So we remember we didn't have refrigeration back then, and You know, today, if you have a piece of meat in the fridge and you pull it out and said, oh, it expired 2 days ago, toss it in the trash. You wouldn't do that in the 13th century. You know, you can't afford to waste food. So if it's kind of like, you know, getting on the little rank side over there, put some pepper on it and it does really well. But the thing that most people don't forget or maybe not don't realize is that spices were extremely expensive. And because of how expensive and scarce they were, they actually became a status symbol, much like owning a Ferrari or a Louis Vuitton purse would be today. So if you were a nobleman and you had access to pepper, cinnamon, nutmeg, any of those things in your household would indicate how wealthy you are because they were very, very expensive. Now, if you're wondering, I mean, we know they're expensive today, but they were very expensive 1,000 years ago. And the reason for this is because of the way the spice trade was run. So now the spice trade started around 1000 BCE. Spices were picked up in Asia and Southeast Asia and delivered to Indonesia and Egypt originally. And then by 120 BCE, the Greeks learned the tricks of the trade and began venturing to Asia. Although the Greeks didn't really do too much of this, it was really when the Romans took over Egypt in 30 BCE that the spices began coming to Europe in full force. By the turn of the millennium, a full-blown trading network was operating across the seas of the Far East with India at its center. Now, after Rome's collapse in 250 BCE, the epicenter of world trade shifted first to the Byzantine Empire and then to Europe as it emerged from the quote-unquote Dark Ages. This would be the period after the fall of Rome, around 300, all the way to 1000. They used to be called the Dark Ages, but it's not really fair to call it a Dark Age. A Dark Age would be something where there was no history or anything, reading or anything going on, no education, no nothing, and that's not really true. Yes, there was a lot less education, a lot less reading and writing going on, but there was the Catholic Church, or back then it was the Christian Church, you know, was the only Christian church. They were the ones that kind of kept reading and writing going. So that's kind of a misnomer. Now, during this period, Venice became a worldwide trading powerhouse. Muslims gained control of the spice routes as they took over the Middle East and a large part of Southeast Asia. Even though Venice was using their ships to deliver spices to the rest of Europe, the main part of the spice trade was conducted over land. Arab traders brought their goods from the East through deserts and mountains, which of course made these goods extremely expensive. So if you can see here on this map, see how the majority of these are all over land, done with camels, carts. You know, I used to joke with my students that, you know, we didn't have Allstate back then. So if something terrible happened to your shipments, you were out bankrupt. So you couldn't insure anything. So as you can imagine, a very long, harrowing journey. And of course, not just spices. We're also talking about, we call it the Silk Road. Silk, you know, porcelain, other goods that came from Asia. It's really interesting when the Portuguese first arrived in China, in Japan, they thought, here we are, we're coming to bring you civilization. And meanwhile, China had already invented the clock, had already invented the chair, they'd already had gunpowder. They were well ahead of us. So they really didn't need anything from us, and they were more interested in selling things to Europe. So with these, you know, you're talking here like the Gobi Desert, the mountains here. This is a very harrowing journey. So of course, this is going to make it very expensive. Over the centuries, the Arab traders have built a series of forts and towns throughout the Spice Road or the Silk Road to facilitate and protect their hold over the spice market. Europeans tried breaking in on this, and it's part of the reason the Christian countries were so intent on defeating the Muslims. You know, we hear about the Crusades, and yes, there is a religious aspect to it, because we're talking about, you know, Christians fighting versus quote unquote the infidels. But we also have to remember that, you know, economics is also behind it, because somebody who goes to Jerusalem to go fight has a good way of gaining treasure, gaining land, getting a knighthood. These are all ways that European noblemen could advance themselves when they didn't have other opportunities in Europe. And we're going to see later that in Portugal, that kind of same mentality is going to exist. So, you know, we have to remember that, yes, definitely we can't discount the religious aspect and sentiments behind, you know, what the soldiers were aiming for during the Crusades, but of course they were also motivated by money. And getting in on this Silk Road was one of the things that really kind of what they wanted. And of course, there's a lot of money to be gained. So of course, however, at this time, you know, Europeans did not have the technology to defeat any of these powerful armies. So they resigned themselves that they would not gain control of the market as long as they kept trying to use the land route. There's a reason why a lot of the Portuguese Empire was all on the oceans. At this time, we didn't have the type of firepower necessary. We didn't have the steamships yet. So Europeans in general just did not have the ability to be able to conquer any of the powerful Asian and South Asian nations that existed here. And it's why the Portuguese were intent on trading posts and trying to make friends in the beginning, because they really didn't have the ability to overtake anyone. And they realized this as they, you know, what happened with the Crusades. I mean, yes, they took things here and there, but it was always very tentative and it was just not very easy. So as time went on, it became obvious that if they wanted to take over the spices, they would need to find another way. And that way was to India via the ocean. Now, living in the United States, it's easy to say that we like things big. We like our houses big. We even like our burgers big. So it boggles the minds of many students and people in general, I think, when they learn that it was Portugal, not Spain or France, England, etc., that was the forefront of the oceanic explorations in the 15th century. So I'm sorry if I come across a little nationalistic here, but it's always big chip on my shoulder. You know, people always assume it was Spain and never, ever consider Portugal. And I get it now, but, you know, it just drives me crazy because Spain was nowhere near where Portugal was and in being able to advance this. So how was it that possible that our tiny country was able to beat out all the other kings and queens we learned about in school? The secret is that Portugal was able to unify as a country well before their counterparts. The medieval period in Europe, we're talking about 1000 to around 1500, was one filled with much warfare between the nobles and the kings. Kings fought to maintain control over their kingdoms, but with the feudal system, it was difficult to do so. Dukes, counts, and others had their own massive armies and controlled large amounts of land, so they challenged the authorities of the kings. If we refer back here to this map, and I know it might be hard to see some of these countries, so if you're on your computer, you might be able to, you know, zoom in a little bit. But if you see here, well, you can't see my mouse probably, but here on the very left, of course, in blue is Portugal. And then if you, all of these other different countries, Europe was very, very disunified at this point. The feudal system, the way it worked was you had a, you know, you could say I'm the king of France, for example. And I would have my men, I would have an army, I would own my own lands, and I would collect rents from my peasants and my serfs. But they relied on the surrounding nobles in order to help them, assist them if they got into a fight with someone else. So if the King of England wants to attack the King of France, then the King of France has to call on his vassals, which would be the dukes. And then the dukes would call on their vassals, the counts, and so on and so on and so on until you hopefully you get enough men together that you can be able to fight. The problem is you have, let's say the Duke, he owns several huge tracts of land, and then he might marry the daughter of another Duke. And in her marriage, she brings more lands with her, and the lands bring more peasants, which brings more rents, which affords you bigger armies. And in some cases, some of these nobles had more land and more armies than the king did. And so then the king is without power because he does not have enough armies by himself to overpower his own nobles. And if they gang up, they could gang up on him if they didn't like what he did or what he said. And so this made it very difficult. And you see a lot of fighting, especially we see this between England and France, right, with the Hundred Years' War. And this all happened because, of course, the kings of England kept marrying French countesses and French, you know, the daughters of French dukes and gaining more and more French land. And by the time you get to the 1300s, you have the king of England owning half the land in France and saying, well, I should be king of France, too. Why not? And so a lot of these things were going on, and it made it very difficult for kings to be able to really advance much with their countries, because they're fighting that, they're fighting the church, and it's just not a very smooth, easy thing going on. And that's why we see so many different colors on this map, just because, you know, there's just so much division. Now, if we look at the Iberian Peninsula in general, and to, you know, swing back to Spain, and of course, I'm not trying to hate on our neighbors, although, you know, Castile was definitely one of Portugal's frenemies, as I like to say. They were the our favorite besties that we love to hate, because they're always trying to take over Portugal. But this is especially true in Spain. So obviously, they're the neighbors to Portugal, and people always think, well, why Portugal? Look how small it is compared to the size of Spain. Now, if you see this as a, you know, a map of the Iberian Peninsula around 1200, of course, the Reconquista is almost done. This lime green area at the bottom is more Granada and the Muslim controlled area. What you see under where it says Portugal and it's pink, and then there's this kind of like green, lime green area, that's the Algarve, which eventually, you know, the kings of Portugal actually call themselves kings of Portugal and the Algarve for a very long time. But you see, really, by 1200, Portugal is pretty much almost complete. There's really not much more expansion after this. Portugal was very limited by its boundaries. So you have the Tagus River in the south, over by Lisbon, and in the mountains in the north, Trás-os-Montes. There really wasn't a whole lot of ability for Portugal to expand any more than it did, just because of the geography. And if you look at Spain, you see quite a few different kingdoms: León, Castile, Navarre, Aragon, and of course, as I mentioned, Granada in the bottom. And even to this day, even though Spain is technically unified as a country, Catalonia, I love Barcelona, they still have just recently in the last couple of years voted to get their independence from Spain, which Spain did not like and did not allow. Spain was not unified in by any stretch of the imagination. So we look at it as this monolith, like, oh, it's Spain. But really, they saw themselves for a very long time as I'm Leonese or I'm Aragonese. And Spain itself as a political entity did not unify until 1516. So that really is what held up Spain. And on the other hand, Portugal's small size is what made an ideal place for a much earlier unification. Just a funny little story. So when I was a freshman in college and I took my first Western civilization class, and I wasn't a history major yet, I think it was my first or second day in class, and the professor says, okay, who was the first country in Europe, like unified country? And of course, you know, everybody's raising their hands, and they're shouting France, Spain, England. And he says, no. I'll give you a hint. It starts with P. And I'm not joking. The whole entire class shouted, Poland. He laughed and he said, and I was there saying Portugal. And so the girl in front of me turned around and gave me a look like, oh, you're so stupid. Why would you say Portugal? I was like, really? You think it's Poland? So I think even a Polish nationalist would laugh at that. If you know anything about the sad history of Poland, definitely not Poland. It's Portugal.
Yes, for sure.
A lot of it is thanks to Dom Afonso II, Duke Ugord, or in English, the fat one. Doesn't look very fat in this painting, but, you know, we'll take their word for it. I love these monikers, you know, like the bald, the fat, the unready. But he was the fat. And really, it's Dom Afonso that kind of really starts Portugal on this road of, you know, advancing Portugal to a place where they do become unified. So Dom Afonso was the third Portuguese king. Dom Afonso the first was his grandfather. And then Dom Sancho the first was his father. And by the time Dom Afonso becomes king in 1211, the Reconquista is pretty much done. It's they're really, at least from Portugal's side, there's not really a whole lot of fighting. As I mentioned, Portugal was pretty complete. And Dom Afonso, what was really smart about him was that he recognized that there's really no point in trying to really advance, or like to try to expand his territories any farther, because, you know, if we go back to our little map here of Portugal, you can see here we've got, this is Galicia over Portugal and Leon. You know, we've got Castile over here in the orange. And so, you know, we're done fighting the Muslims, we're done fighting the Moors. And so if they try to expand anymore, it's going to be to fight against the Spanish. And what is the point in that? So he decided that let's just make friends with Castile. There's no need for us to be fighting with them. And let's focus on more important things instead. And so what he really focused on doing during his reign was actually trying to centralize his power. You know, as I mentioned, you know, this was in a world where all of these kings are trying to get power. You know, the advantage of Portugal is that he doesn't have the great expanse of like Germany or France or even Italy, where he has a lot of territory to worry about. So because Portugal is so much smaller, it's so much easier to gain control of, right? Because in the medieval period, whoever owns the most land has the most power. Titles aren't as important because you can be the king, as I mentioned, and have a much smaller amount of land than your cousin, the Duke. So who in effect would have a lot more power than the king, even though he doesn't call himself the king yet. And so Dumfries recognized like, okay, if I am going to get control over this country, I need to make sure that I have the most power. So it took a little bit of, you know, kind of kick out some of his family members, exile them out, make sure they couldn't cause any trouble. And he focused on really making sure that, you know, A, we had peace. So he sent ambassadors all over Europe trying to, you know, make allies with European monarchs. As I mentioned, he made peace with Castile, which was really good. Really focused on just making sure he also had a written set of laws that he made, which is our first written set of laws in Portuguese history. You know, a few kings down the road, we're going to get the Ordenações de Alfonsinas, which will be like the codification of Portuguese law. So really, I mean, it's really advanced for the period. The only thing that kind of, you know, Afonso didn't do so well was the church. So when Dom Afonso the First, you know, he needed to get recognition of Portugal by the Pope. And in order to get that recognition in 1147, he had to have the Pope, he had to agree that the Pope would have, the church would have their own power within Portugal, and kind of made it almost a state within a state. And so Dom Afonso was like, okay, if I need to get control over the country, I need to, you know, kind of break this. But it proved too powerful. The Pope definitely won this battle. He got excommunicated, and he had promised the Pope that he was going to stop, and the Pope was going to let him, you know, lift this excommunication, which for those who are not familiar with, you know, this language, you'd be excommunicated from the Catholic Church at that period meant, you know, you're out of the church, you're not going to heaven, you're probably going to hell, don't pass go, don't collect $200, just go straight to hell, just go see the devil, right? And so for the Alphonse, he was supposed to be lifted, and he died before that could happen. So unfortunately, he died while excommunicated. The excommunication is a very powerful tool, as for the popes could use, kind of hold this over the heads of the kings, because if you excommunicate a king, you know, Christians are not going to follow a king who's excommunicated, right? Another tool that popes used was also the interdict, which would say, okay, well, there's an interdict over the country. You cannot perform any sacraments, no communion, no baptisms, no marriages, nothing. And so that would also could turn the people against their king, because now their very own very souls are in danger. And so we saw definitely the Pope played hardball here, and Pope won. His son will also try to go toe to toe with the Pope and gets himself excommunicated too, but that's for another day. But the main importance of this is that by Dom Afonso being able to centralize his power, at least with the nobles, what he created was a situation where the king doesn't have to fight his own people. You know, he might have his beef with the church, but at least he's not having to worry that every day, you know, his nobles, every time he tries to pass a law or every time he tries to decree something, that the nobles are going to join together and gang up on him and try to overthrow him. So now the king's secure in his throne. And with that, and we're not worried about wars with anybody else either, which is also really good, because now we have time and we have money to do other things. And this is how we get Prince Henry. So I hope most who are watching are familiar with the Prince Dom Henrique, or as more colloquially known as Prince Henry the Navigator. The only reason I say that is I grew up in school, I was taught about him, Prince Henry the Navigator, and then when I was teaching and I brought him up, I got a lot of blank stares. So I'm not really sure if, you know, he's really taught much, or I think he might be mentioned as a little blurb. You know, of course, the Portuguese part of me thinks he should be very important, and he is actually really important to the discoveries So he was lived from 1394 to 1460. He was the third son of Don Juan I, the first Avige king. Prince Henry was the Duke of Viseu. And the reason that he's known as a navigator, and why I have the navigator in quotation marks, is because he didn't actually navigate anywhere. So this moniker comes from a couple of German historians from the 19th century, and they called him the navigator. And I'll explain why in a little bit, but it's a false statement because he never actually navigated anywhere. And it's something that in the 19th century, when this was promoted by the Portuguese government, and it was promoted again by Salazar, because it was a way of saying, you know, okay, look, you know, he was Prince Henry the Navigator, and everybody recognizes that. Yay for us. So it's okay. Prince Henry was a really interesting fellow. As I mentioned, you know, since we're not crusading, you know, he's not crusading. No Reconquista. Third son of the king, he's a Duke of Viseu, but he's not happy with just his, you know, I'm the Duke of Viseu, big deal. You can't fight against his dad. Dad has the most power. So how am I, as a son, how can I make more money? How can I improve myself? How can I get more titles? You know, sometimes I always wonder, you know, I'm sure that there's lots of different people who are very ambitious, but I guess being surrounded by Portuguese people, I always think like, oh, we Portuguese people are very ambitious. We're very motivated. And I always wonder if maybe that isn't like in the blood, but definitely if you meet anybody, Prince Henry is definitely one of our most ambitious people that I've seen. And one of his obsessions, though, aside from the discoveries, was, of course, fighting the Moors in North Africa. And as I mentioned before, you know, part of this is religiously motivated, but a lot of it has had to do with him trying to conquer the city of Ceuta in Morocco, where you see here. So over where you see the red, little red cursor, that's where Ceuta is. It's right across from Gibraltar. And of course, you know, that's right across the Straits of Gibraltar from Spain. Now, this is one of the bigger trading posts used by the Arab traders for the spices, and Prince Henry envisioned conquering it and taking it, you know, taking their places in the spice trade. So he figured if we could conquer Ceuta, then we, the Portuguese, could, and of course under me, because it's my expedition, then we can take control of this area, and then we can take their places as this important kind of cog in the whole spice road, Silk Road network. So, and he thought, and as a plus, we're doing it for Jesus. Yay. So it's all good. We're going to do a great thing here. So he and his brothers invaded Ceuta in 1415, and they technically won the battle. So the Portuguese did manage to take over Ceuta during this time. But Ceuta never did bring the riches that he was hoping for. And despite this, he never gave up hope on this city. Now, later in 1437, Henry's armies attacked the city of Tangiers, but he lost. And he made a treaty with the King of Morocco because, of course, the Moroccans are very upset that Ceuta has been taken over by the Portuguese. And so the treaty stated, and the treaty that Henry signed stated that, okay, we will give back Ceuta. But the King of Morocco doesn't trust Henrique at all. He says, okay, I'm going to trust you. So here's what you're going to do. I want you to leave your brother Fernand. You're going to leave him here with me. And then when you're going to get home, because then Henry's like, okay, but I got to clear things with my brother, Duarte. He's the king. And I don't have the power to say this. He's like, okay, that's fine. I'll keep Fernand here with me as my prisoner. You go back to Portugal. You clear things with your brother. And then when I see the okay, when I see all of your troops leave there, I will send Fernand back to Portugal. You have my word on it. And he says, okay, we'll do that. And he never did. So poor Fernand, as l'infant saint, or the holy prince, or the saintly prince, I guess you could even say, poor guy. Sadly, Henry never fulfilled his part of the bargain, and Fernand died in captivity in 1443. So he just, it's really sad. I mean, it's very Machiavellian of Henry, I guess, you know, taking one for the team. This is for the patria. Like, I'm sorry, brother, you have to die because we need to keep Ceuta. Unfortunately, this is one of those, I don't want to say being faked, but this is one of those like moments where you're like, it was really all for nothing, because Ceuta, it was a bust. You know, they took over Ceuta, but in the end, it never got the Portuguese what they wanted because they thought they could just replace the Arabs as they were there. But what they didn't realize is the Arabs who were controlling the city had a relationship with the traders. And so once the Portuguese took over the city, those traders stopped going and Ceuta became a ghost town. Now, of course, the Portuguese held on to it just for to save face. But in the end, that city cost them way more than it was worth because they had to send men to defend it constantly. They had to send supplies. People lived in the city. And it was just, you know, worthless. It finally gets given to the English in 1661 when Dona Catarina marries Charles II of Portugal. And of course, Dona Luisa took a big beating over that. People were very upset because we're losing the patria, but it was a worthless piece of junk by this point, and they just nobody realized it. It was just kind of like, hey, you know, we were losing part of our empire, but it definitely was not worth the price that was paid. Now, Henry was an ambitious man, as I mentioned. He was determined to tap into this West African gold trade that was going on already in Africa. And of course, he was looking to see if he could find the legendary Prester John, this idea that, you know, we could just find our riches in Africa. And so even, as I mentioned, even though he's known as a navigator, Henry never actually navigated anywhere except to Morocco. It's the only place he sailed to. Otherwise, he stayed in Portugal. As a side note, when he started being known as Henry the Navigator, I always joke that, you know, the British were really jumped on this. And of course, you know, for those of you who don't know, Enrique's mother, Filippo, was English. She was Filippo of Lancaster. And so the English said, oh, that explains it. Portugal beat us because Henry was half English. Must have been his English blood that made this possible. So we can take some credit for this. If he had been full-blooded Portuguese, this probably wouldn't have happened. So not true, but they can think what they want. And Henry was really the quintessential venture capitalist is really what he was. He may not have sailed anywhere, and he may not have invented anything personally, but his money and his influence are what allowed for all of the advances that happened during this period to occur. Namely, the caravel, which was a new ship that was invented during this period, a much lighter and faster ship that was more easily able to navigate down the coast. It was his ships that discovered the Azores Islands, the islands of Madeira, and his ships started the push down to the coast of West Africa. There's also a myth that he started a navigational school in the village of Sagres, but that never happened. Just like the Sagres Brewery is not in Sagres either. So I guess there's a lot of myths going on in Sagres. He did, however, bring the most knowledgeable and gifted scholars and maritime experts from all over the world to form sort of think tank to pull together all of their knowledge. So that's how these new innovations came about, was because he kind of brought the smartest people in the world together and had them work together to figure out, like, how can we do this better? Because, of course, you know, we know the Americas existed, but back then they didn't. And so contrary to Columbus's belief, the distance between Portugal and Japan is 9,000 miles, and they knew that. So, you know, how can we catch the winds better? How can we, you know, go west and not get stuck out there? Because, of course, the trade winds, you know, we have winds that, you know, blow one way for a certain number of months, and then they blow the other way. And so if you don't have a motor or an engine, how do you keep your ship from, you know, being lost at sea? And so, of course, going down the coast is the much easier route. And they knew that if they made it, as you see on this map, around the Horn of Africa, then they would eventually end up in India. And that's our ultimate goal. Henry was definitely a man of many contradictions. And he's so funny. In some ways, he was so brilliant, and he was so forward-thinking, because, I mean, to think of, like, say, okay, let's just, you know, use the knowledge of people from Venice and people from, you know, the Middle East and people from Greece and you know, all of these different things to get them together to discuss maritime technology and advances and to make all these things happen, but still be so, like, book in some ways. So one of the things that really just Henry was obsessed with were the Canary Islands, as you can see where they are kind of off the coast of Africa. Now, the Castilians began conquering the Canary Islands in 1402, and Henry was obsessed. Like the Portuguese wanted the Canary Islands. I don't know why. You know, there's nothing really special about them. They had native people that were already living there, which unfortunately became extinct due to the amount of conquests that happened. I don't know if it was because of this, stick it to the Castilians kind of thing, but Castile and Portugal definitely fought a lot over the Canary Islands. And Henry never lost this vision or this dream of having possessing the Canary Islands. Yes, they would be a good stopping point, but I mean, really, so far in North Africa, it's kind of worthless. But and this also passed down to the generations that came after him. So this desire, they all wanted the Canary Islands, and but the desire ended in 1481 with the papal bull, a Eterni Regis, or which in English means of the King's Eternal Grace, and the Treaty of Alcazabes, which was signed between Portugal and Castile. So this treaty ended the War of Castilian Succession, which was fought between Afonso V of Portugal and Isabel of Castile. Now, this war happened because Isabel, La Reina Católica, she's a very interesting character. And her husband Fernando definitely, anyway, sorry. But Isabel, in order for her to become Queen of Castile, she essentially had to steal the throne from her niece. So her brother Enrique died and left a little baby named Juana as his sole heir. Now, Juana was a baby, and Isabel was much older, and she wanted to be Queen of Castile and thought, okay, what is the best way to steal the throne? She started implying that Juana was not, in fact, the legitimate daughter of Enrique, but was actually a bastard. So the rumors, she spread the rumors that she was actually the daughter of Juan Beltran, who was one of the advisors of the king, and called her La Beltraneja and all these different things. And because she was just a baby, it was difficult for Juana to defend herself and to be able to defend her throne. And so Isabel won. And of course, she married Fernando. Fernando of Aragon helped. So they essentially hoisted the baby out of the throne, and poor Juana ended up queenless without her throne and her crown. So Juana ends up marrying Afonso V, Wulfric. And one of Juana's dreams is that her husband now has an army, and he's gonna storm Castile, and he's gonna steal her throne back and make her Queen of Castile again. And Afonso loves this idea because, as much as I joke and say that the Castilians are always trying to take over Portugal, Portugal always had the same ideas too. So don't get me wrong. Definitely, there's a lot of times when the Portuguese, if they could have taken over Castile, they would have. And Afonso saw this as his legitimate excuse for going to war with Castile. So they go to war, but in the end, Afonso gives up. And that's why they signed this treaty. And why this treaty is important is because this treaty grants the Canary Islands forevermore to Castile, which would make Henry sad. But in exchange, it says that nobody, the Spanish, cannot sail below the Canary Islands, that all of the African possessions and eventually what would come in the East is going to be the property of Portugal. And the papal bull that was signed that confirmed this and threatened excommunication for anyone who violated the papal bull. So it means that if anybody else wanted to sail south of the Canary Islands and follow what Portugal was doing, they would have to do so in secret, because if you find out, then you could risk getting excommunicated by the Pope and violating this treaty and causing a war. So it was a big deal. And actually, as a side note, this is going to be very important with the Treaty of Tordesillas, because when Columbus goes to the New World and he thinks he's gone to India, and then he heads back to Castile to tell Isabel, hey, I made it, he has to make a pit stop in Portugal. This guy is so such a baby, but he had to stop in Portugal. So Don Juan Segundo had told, or the second had told Columbus, look, your idea is crazy. There's no way you're going to make it to Japan. It's 9,000 miles. And Columbus says, oh, no, it's only 2,000 miles. I'll make it in no time. So, of course, he thinks he's made it to India. He only went 2 or 3,000 miles, and he's like, "See, I told him." So he comes back and he makes stops in Portugal and tells the king, "Hey, I did it. Ha ha ha. You thought you were so smart, but you're not." And Don Juan says, "Well, that's interesting because according to the treaty we have with Castile, you're not supposed to go to India." And so I always think, like, if this was like modern times, you'd call up the Pope and say, "Hey, Pope, I'm mad." He's like the yard duty instructor or whatever. But and then that case, so then Don Juan did bring that up with Isabel. I'm sure Isabel was really irritated with Columbus. She's like, "You couldn't just keep your big mouth shut." So then that's why the Pope then made the treaty, the Tordesillas, which we see here, if you can see on this map. The treaty split the world instead of splitting it lengthwise, I'm sorry, widthwise, which we saw before was underneath the Canary Islands. Now it's going to split the world lengthwise and say, okay, we're going to split the world from north to south. Whatever is on this side of the Americas will be for Castile, eventually Spain, and everything on the right side is for Portugal. And something that's really interesting that I find so fascinating is if you read the actual treaty, the treaty says it has to be 270 leagues west of the Cape Verde Islands. So the Cape Verde Islands are right there, not too far from the Canary Islands. But we didn't know Brazil existed yet because technically it wasn't discovered until 1500. And this treaty is written much earlier in 1494. So, of course, there's the conspiracy theories out there that say, okay, did Don Juan know that Brazil was there? They didn't tell anybody because he did have a secret map that he kept locked up in his office. And so it's very possible they already knew Brazil was there. And that's why they insisted it had to be 270 leagues west. Could also be a coincidence, but I love the conspiracy theory. I think that's fun. Anyway, so that's why that treaty was so important. And saying that nobody else could go south of the Canary Islands gave Portugal the free rein to just, go all they wanted and, explore all they wanted, and why they were able to make it to India without anybody else really interfering. Of course, also, as I mentioned, Spain doesn't even become unified till 1516. And, even though Columbus, yes, went in 1492, that was all private money, and it wasn't, royal funded like it was in Portugal. They had to rely all on entrepreneurs who wanted to fund expeditions and hopefully try to find some gold to make money. So the Spanish Empire really does evolve much differently than the Portuguese Empire, mainly because you do have these profiteers who are just out there like, "Hey, I'm here to make a fortune. I've invested a lot of money. I need to make some of my money back." Whereas, like, the other ones are like on the government pension, I guess, government contract. And so they're like, "Hey, I don't need to kill a bunch of people to get money because, I'm being paid either way." So anyway, but yeah, so that treaty was super important. And that, so that's one of the like final, like one of the other major reasons why, kind of Portugal had this advantage in the beginning to start these explorations. And it really just kind of came out of, there's a lot of different pieces that kind of came together to sort of made this perfect moment to allow, the Portuguese to be the ones to just set sail from that ocean and just, kind of start the momentum, of eventually making it to India in 1498, and of course having the corner on the spice market for so many years. And as we see, the Portuguese explorations, even though, we may not, we lost a lot of our empire for different reasons over the centuries, but the remnants of the Portuguese influence is so obvious in a lot of places. If you, well, it is if you look for it, right? And, as I've mentioned in prior podcasts, we talked about like the tempura from Japan was invented by the Portuguese. The ukulele in Hawaii was invented by the Portuguese. And even today, here in Modesto, where I am, I've run into several people from India who have Portuguese names. Fernandes, I met one lady, her name is Silvina Fernandes, does not speak any Portuguese, has never spoken Portuguese, but they have Portuguese names. And it's just so amazing how we see these little glimpses of our influence and what the Portuguese were able to accomplish, just from these little hints and how many years they've lasted and they continue to last. So it's kind of something really I think to be proud of, for us as Portuguese Americans and really any Lusophone people out there. So that is it. Thank you. Any questions?
Okay. Fantastic.
I'll share my screen now.
Sure. Fantastic as always. I have about a million questions, but we don't have time for a million, but we'll get some. I do have a question comment. I mean, of course, you, I know as a historian, you follow a lot of the things about and this theory about Columbus being Portuguese. He may have been Portuguese because he couldn't keep his mouth shut. That may be what gave it away that he is Portuguese. Which I when you were mentioning that, a couple of things. First of all, when you said when you were talking about the Spain being a not the Spain of today, but of course a collage of different kingdoms, and it still isn't. I think that. As you mentioned, it still isn't a very, very tight-knit country. I mean, Catalonia, as you mentioned, is on the brink of independence. And I think, some historians and modern day, that look at mostly even political scientists, look at it at the possibility that's going to happen as Europe evolves. If Europe evolves, and I want to get your thoughts on it. If Europe evolves into a more of a federated Europe of different regions, where the states have a secondary position instead of a federated union of nations, if the nations lose a little bit of their sovereignty to this idea of a unified Europe, it's not totally uncalled for. From many perspectives, what is yours at Catalonia and the Basque may be independent. Who knows? I mean, it's just,
Yeah, I think for Catalonia, I have a special affection because, the Spanish actually did take over Portugal from 1580 to 1640, which we call the Babylonian captivity. We don't speak of it. Actually, very little. You find like the least amount of research is done in that period. It's like we're trying to pretend like it never happened. But we can actually thank Portuguese independence today to the Catalonians, because the Catalonians also revolted in 1640. And the Castilians were so busy dealing with the Catalonians, because they were difficult, that they didn't notice that we revolted. So by the time we had revolted, we'd thrown out the Duchess of Mantua, we'd thrown her out, we declared independence. It was 2 months before the Spanish even realized what had happened. And that was thanks to them. And I think, if we're talking about a world of self-determination, I don't think it's right if you have a free and peaceful election where you vote and you say, this is how, we've never felt Spanish. They don't even speak Spanish. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's right for Spain to continue. I don't know if necessarily all of Europe needs to break up into, different regions. But I do think that, if we are going to be a world where we talk about the importance of democracy, we talk about the importance of, a people being self-determined, that we shouldn't rely on 17th century maps to determine what country you belong to. And if they don't feel like they're part of Spain, I don't think they should be forced to stay there. The same goes for the Basques.
Sure, sure. It's just, there's a lot of, it depends on the evolution of Europe and yeah. this new European union and this period of peace, as you know, and as you noted in some of the podcasts that we used to do on a regular basis, this recent and period of peace in the last since World War II. Prior to that, Europe was always at war. I mean, it was part of in the blood. And sometimes when people say we're European, sometimes I question that, because we're European, but the nations, I think most Frenchmen consider themselves Frenchmen first and then European second, and Portuguese the same, and Italians. It's because these are old countries. I mean, as you just mentioned, Portugal being one of the oldest, but these are countries that have been around for a long time. And that brings to the point of the Basque and the Basque country and O País Vasco and Catalonia, because they were for a long time their own kingdom before, right, this kind of almost, quote unquote fake, you know, and right. I put the word in quotes,
well,
you know.
Yeah. And I mean, Catalonia was fine. Even after Charles V took over, became Carlos I, this is Isabel's grandson, took over and sort of unified Spain, as I mentioned, the Catalonians were fine. As long as the Spanish left them alone, let them do whatever they want. You could call us part of Spain, we don't care. It was only when Philip the Fourth started really imposing on Catalan, on the Catalonians and saying, okay, you need to pay us taxes to Madrid. You need to send, we're going to send governors over there. That's when they really started getting upset and not liking it. So I think for them, especially, it's like, you know, they're not, they just want to be able to do their own thing and have everybody just leave them alone, which I don't blame them.
Sure. And, you know, of course, all this history always has an impact on what's going on today. I mean, you know, the reason, as you have taught us, you know, to research and to read and to understand history is that we don't make the same mistakes yeah. over and over and over again, which seems like especially men, the men have been the ones controlling the world that have a very short memory and like to forget things. But one of the things that was all of the presentation, of course, was interesting. But when you talked about Henry the Navigator or Infante Dom Henrique and his brother that stayed behind, I recall, you know, from elementary school in Portugal, it was called the Inquirente Geração, you know, they were like the enlightened, you know, generation. But never much was talked about Fernando. And it was when Fernando was talked about, it was basically from the in elementary school in Portugal and even some secondary school as well. It was always from that he was this martyr that did this in honor of the country. It wasn't, yeah. They forgot about the little piece that, you know, Henry didn't come through, right?
Right. Yeah, I think there was a lot of like, you know, because, you know, trying to separate like a lot of, especially the guys like Don Juan and Don Henrique and all these, there's so much, they're like George Washington, right? There's all of these like myths that surround us. So I know there were people that talked about and said, oh, that Fernand told him, don't worry about me, brother. Just leave me here because see if it's more important. I highly doubt he said that. Yeah. So, yeah.
And when you mentioned, it was interesting also when you talked about China and when you talked about the tempura and the Portuguese, I mean, you know, sometimes, and bring it to today's history, you know, just recently, as you know, when it was all a political ploy, but, you know, the president of China that stopped in the Azores, if you remember, you know, stopped in a couple of islands or stopped meeting, I think, in Terceira. And people were talking, you know, and of course, Portuguese Americans depending sometimes because of a certain political persuasion, but sometimes just, you know, of both political persuasions here in the United States, people were saying, you know, how can the Portuguese do that? How can the Portuguese talk to the Chinese? You know, we have a strong relationship with the Chinese that goes back many centuries.
Yeah, for sure.
And you mentioned that. I mean, it's just so it's our relationship with the Chinese is not a new thing of the China today. It's not right. Our relationship predates the communist Chinese, you know, yeah. by many, many. And so do you think as a historian, do you think that positions Portugal sometimes well to deal with these situations that other countries haven't because of our relationship in the past?
I think so. I really do. I mean, because, you know, I mean, they say that the Portuguese passport is like the third best passport in the world because, like, for instance, if you have a Portuguese passport, you can travel to Macau and Hong Kong without a visa. And so I really do think that, you know, our kind of former role in the world kind of puts us in a position where, you know, we don't feel like we have these ancient connections with England or with China or with Japan. And we have this like long established relationship that I think that it makes it easier. We don't have these prior like preconceived notions, I guess.
Sure, sure. And I love your looking at the conspiracy theories of the 12th and 13th and 14th and 15th centuries. But you know, the conspiracy theories then were a lot nicer than the conspiracy theories now in our politics, aren't they?
Definitely.
I mean, they were about a queen that, you know, had these secret love affairs and right. all this kind of stuff. You know, it was a little bit different, you know, than what we deal with today. I want to ask also one other question before we let you go, of course. And I thank you so much for taking this time and for this wonderful presentation. Thanks to all the nice comments we're getting on social media and here as well, which is that... The I mean, we don't want to get stuck on the past, but by the same token, and as a historian, of course, you might have a different take because the past is important. We all agree with that. But sometimes not from a Portuguese centric, you know, idea, you know, that, as you mentioned, you even mentioned, I'm maybe here in this aspect, I may sound a little bit nationalistic, but indeed there has been a very, very big conflict, including us losing our independence for 60 years mm-hmm. with Spain. It's not like Spain and Portugal have been friendly neighbors. Right. And then they were competing, as you mentioned, for a world market. And then, of course, you know, we have the English with that with the alliance. But how important do you think is for Portuguese Americans, whether they're second generation, especially second, third, fourth generation, given that there's so much, so little, and even becoming less and less and less and less of the age of discoveries taught in American schools, because we don't do the best job with world history, number one. And then now, you know, there's this look at the conquistadors, and, you know, and some of them were brutal dudes, you know, and some of them were horrible, but not all of them were, you know. I mean, we also have to look at history. Sometimes people want to talk about these folks like they live in today's world, you know. Yeah. As a historian, you know, what would you tell people? First of all, you know, what would you tell people when people are readily and easily wanting to condemn someone, you know, for what they did by today's standards and not by, you know, how the world happened, you know, in the 12 or 1300s or 14 or 1500s. What, as a historian, what would you tell people?
Do you mean like, what would I tell them, like how important it is to learn?
Yeah, to know the history and to go beyond looking at history with only today's lenses. I mean, let it be a history, a lesson for us not to repeat some of the things.
Yes.
But some of these things, I mean, but the world was different 800 years ago.
Yes. It was different and it's the same. And I think people want to think it's different. And I think that's why it is so important for us to try to look at history without our preconceived, like you were mentioning, like not looking with today's lenses, right? For example, we look at, you know, the Reconquista. Or, you know, Queen Isabel of Castile in particular, where she, you know, she expelled the Jews and then she fought against Granada and she expelled the Muslims. And people say, and really her intention is, okay, me as the Queen of Castile, I don't feel like I can rule over my kingdom. I mean, again, we always have to keep the religious aspect in mind because that was very real for people, yes. But we forget that there's also the other human side of people and the practical side where she's saying, will a Jewish subject follow me as closely as a Christian one would, or would they try to get rid of me if they could, right? And so then my students would think like, well, that's terrible. Why do we care what religion these people are? And it's like, but today we still have a lot of people who, you know, if we had a president who was running for the United States, it was not a Christian, you know, was Muslim or was an atheist or, you know, Buddhist. There are a lot of people that would be really upset with that. And so these, you know, we say it's different, but it's not really. And, you know, going back to your, you know, what you were mentioning about like the conquistadors, for example, you know, there's something that we call the Black Legend, where it's like, we look at the Spanish and we're like, oh, they were all evil and they were all terrible and they did a lot of horrible things. Yes, a lot of horrible things happen. But we tend to focus too much on, well, it was because of the Reconquista. No, that was pretty much over even in Spain. That had nothing to do with explorations. If we look at the economic side of it, as I mentioned, you know, you have a lot of young European nobles running around Europe. If you're the winner of the genetic lottery and you're the first son, you get everything, right? The second son goes to the church. What is the third son going to do? Look at Henry. Henry was able to leverage his money and his influence into something positive, right? He still did a lot of negative things though. And luckily, you know, the explorations, discovering the Azores, I'm happy about that. But you know, all of those things, you know, were positive things, but it overshadows, as you mentioned, people don't mention about Don Fernand. You know, they don't talk about when his obsession with fighting against the Moors, the quote unquote infidels, right? And so it's like so you have a lot of those mini Enriques now, you know, let loose in the Americas and saying like, okay, you can get as much money as you want. Just I, the king, have to keep a fifth of it. So that is going to really make them much more likely to like be more aggressive, to be more, you know, insistent and commit murders. Not that that's a good thing, but there's that other factor that's involved in that we don't think about, you know. And then so when we compare the Portuguese to the Spanish, and then we say, oh, the Portuguese are so much nicer, you know, I like it, that makes us look nicer, but really there's a whole set of other a whole nother system put into place and a whole nother goals in place for the Portuguese than there were for the Spanish. And so if we look at, like, we think that oh man, people today are so greedy, people have always been greedy, people today are so ruthless, people have always been ruthless. You put money in front of people, you put unlimited amounts of gold, like when you find the Aztecs. I mean, Hernan Cortez was lucky. He burned down his ship. He, you know, killed the messenger from the king that said, turn around or I'm going to execute you. But he got lucky because he got the Aztec gold, right? And then that's why he ended up becoming a marquess and not getting executed like he should have been for defying the king. But it's all because of money. So yeah, we definitely, I think it's almost like, yes, we don't want to put a definitely don't want to put a modern lens on when we look at these historical things. But then we also need to wipe away our own lens when we look at from history this way and say, like, okay, people are motivated by the same things back then that they're motivated today. You know, the same things that scared them back then are the same things that scare people today. And then that's why it's important, like going back to what you said, to study history, because, you know, the problem is we do keep repeating the same things over and over again, but the problem is we always think it's different. Yes, we're doing this again, but it's different this time. You know, we're smarter, we have more advancement, we're more enlightened, whatever it is, but really in the end, it's not.
Indeed. And to end, overall, with some things not as positive, some things, you know, less desirable, even if we're looking with a different lens. But overall, what is your kind of, you know, assessment of the discoveries for Portugal and for Europe? And for the world. I mean, obviously, for Europe, it was a plus, 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 plus. But overall, how is you as a historian, as someone who studied this, as someone who studied the Portuguese monarchy, I would say better than many other people, many, 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 even including in Portugal as well. You're special in the monarchy. How do you look overall at the discoveries for Portugal and for the world?
Oh my gosh. Well,
with some ambivalence, or you know.
Well, I mean, definitely for Portugal, it obviously, you know, like you said, A++++, and for Europe in general, I mean, this is such a complicated thing, because yes, on the one hand, we get globalization, right? Like we get, you know, chocolate, which is great, and, you know, chili peppers and, you know, corn and potatoes and everything. And the globalization of encountering with other cultures, you know, being easier access to the East and everything like that, that's a plus. But of course, you know, for Portugal, and a lot of money, but then of course, with more money, more problems, right? And so trying to manage all of that, that's difficult. And of course, all of the, I mean, I think for Portugal, it was good. It kept Portugal out of a lot of the European conflicts because they were busy doing this, mm-hmm. you know? So that part was good. I think the unintended consequences of like the slave trade, obviously the, you know, the genocide of the indigenous, we definitely can't overlook that. So probably for Portugal and Europe, yay, maybe B. For everybody else, not so good. You know, that's kind of like the, I mean, we were talking about the way you know, he's looking for he's trying to horn in on the West African gold trade. And instead they end up finding the slave trade, you know, and that, you know, is obviously like for the world, probably not so good, you know.
But with all of these pluses and a lot of negatives as well, as you mentioned, it's still important for Portuguese Americans, whether they're second, third, fourth generation, that are interested in who they are, to know this, because this is part of who we are. We can't go away from it.
Yeah. Well, I think it's important for everybody. And not just because my kids always tease me that, you know, I'm very nationalistic. But, you know, it is important because, you know, the with what Portugal did is so interesting, but it has ramifications throughout everything. And I think it's also important to, you know, if we look at something like the slave trade, but to see how it developed. And not just, you know, not everything happened because of evil intentions necessarily. They turned out to be that way. But yeah, I think it's definitely important for Portuguese Americans, especially, but anybody to really understand like what happened with the Portuguese explorations, especially when we consider this model and compare it to like what the Spanish did, what the Dutch did, because we kind of see like these, as time goes on, these evolutions of these different empires and how they react to encountering these, you know, different civilizations. But just think of the exchange of ideas too and culture, like say Francis Xavier going to Japan and, the Portuguese going to China and bringing, you know, not only bringing Portuguese, you know, culture there, but also taking home the Chinese culture. I mean, you know, mythically, I don't know, I haven't found the proof of this yet, but Catherine of Braganza is the one that brought the fork to England, but she did bring tea drinking to England, which was not a thing in the 17th century, and that came from us, and we got that from the Chinese. So, yeah, I mean, definitely has huge amounts of influence on us.
Yeah, and linguistically and everything, you know, we're the only Romance language that use sha, you know, every else,
yeah.
Tea, you know.
Right.
But we had a different,
even
in the word.
Conversely, the Japanese say arigato, which came from obrigado.
Yeah, and there's been, so there were these cultural exchanges that would have not happened with, you know, some of the bad things that also came out of it. Well, Monique, as always, fascinating. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. We, of course, miss your conversations every week, but we'll try this once in a while. Thank you so much. I appreciate
it. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And thank you for all you do for the community. Appreciate that as well. Thank you. Take care.